Okay, after looking at heterogeneous mixture, okay, we'll move over to a homogeneous mixture. So a homogeneous mixture has a definite composition in comparison to a heterogeneous mixture and specific properties. Okay, in a homogeneous mixture, the different parts cannot be seen, but in a heterogeneous mixture, the different components can be seen. A solution of salt dissolved in water is an example of a homogeneous mixture. When the salt dissolves, it spreads evenly through the water so that all parts of the solution are the same, homo, and then you can no longer see the salt as being separate from the water. Okay, now, okay, so think also of coffee without milk. The air we breathe is another example of a homogeneous mixture since it is made up of different gases which are in constant ratio and which can't be visually distinguished from each other, and that is, you can't see the different components. Now, come below. He said, do you know that an alloy is a homogeneous mixture of two or more elements? An alloy, at least one of which is a metal, where the resulting material has metallic properties. For example, steel is an alloy made up of mainly from iron and a small amount of carbon to make it harder, because one of the importance of alloys is to make the main metal to make it solid, or to strengthen the metallic properties of that matter. Steel is an alloy made up of carbon, okay, made up of iron, a small amount of carbon, manganese and chromium. Please take note. I think, yes, this question, I've seen it in among JAMB past questions. Steel is made up of what? So it's an alloy of iron, carbon, manganese, and chromium. Copper, what do you call it now? Copper plus zinc, you have brass. Brass is an alloy of copper and zinc. While copper and tin, you have bronze. Yes, bronze is an alloy of copper and tin. So, steel alloy is a homogeneous mixture of two or more elements. Okay, we said a homogeneous mixture is one that is uniform and where the different components of the mixture cannot be seen. So, look at the examples. Below, you can try them out yourselves. You can state whether the mixture is a homogeneous mixture or a heterogeneous mixture based on the analysis we've given so far. Sugar dissolved in water, then flour and iron filling, small pieces of irons. From how do you determine that? You look at the definition I gave for both of them. You decide whether or not you can see the components. You decide whether or not the components are uniformly mixed. Then you give your final answer. Now, we see that the first one, sugar dissolved in water, is an homogeneous mixture, while flour mixed with iron filings, that one is an heterogeneous mixture, because you can see the flour, you can see the pieces of iron. Quickly, we move over to separation process or technique. What is a separation technique? Okay, we said it's a method. I think this is one of the topics, yes, in SS1, yes, senior secondary school one. So we're looking at deep analysis into this topic that likely comes out in JAMB examinations. All right, so a separation technique or process is a method that converts a mixture or solution of chemical substances into two or more distinct product mixtures. Separation techniques, separation process for separating chemical substances into distinct product mixtures. At least one of results of the separation is enriched in one or more of the source mixture's constituents. What that means is that after the separation process has been done, one of the products is to a large degree weightier, yeah, or contains more properties than the other. In some cases, the separation may fully divide the mixture into pure constituents. Separations exploit differences in chemical processes or physical processes, such as the size, the shape, the mass, and the density or the chemical affinity between the constituents of a mixture. What that is trying to tell us is before we employ any separation technique for any substance, we'll need to check either the chemical properties, the difference in the chemical properties of the substances involved, or the difference in their physical properties, rather. Now, so with a few exceptions, elements or compounds exist in nature in an impure state. So often, these raw materials must go through a separation before they can be put to productive use, making separation techniques important or essential for the modern industrial economy. In some cases, these separations require total purification. Yes, when we enter, when we start looking at metals, and now they can be extracted. You know, metals can be extracted by electrolysis, yes, then by purification of metals, yeah, or by reduction of the metals. When we look at the ores like aluminium ores, bauxite, and all the rest. You have cassiterite for tin, bauxite for aluminium, and all those stuff. We're going to look at all those stuff as we proceed, okay? So some of these techniques require total purification, as in the electrolysis, refining of bauxite ore for aluminium metal. But a good example of an incomplete separation technique is oil refining. Oil refining is the process involved is an incomplete separation technique. Okay, quickly, before we start looking at the analysis of each of the separation techniques, I think this is what we're going to draw the curtain for today's class, and look at some likely jam questions that comes out from these areas. I'm telling you, if you follow these classes in-depthly and you focus and put into practice most of the things you are doing in this group, I'm telling you, you excel. Yes, you excel in the forthcoming exams. All right? Crude oil occurs naturally as a mixture of various hydrocarbons and impurities. The refining process splits this mixture into other more valuable mixtures such as natural gas, that's methane, CH4, gasoline, and chemical feedstocks, none of which are pure substances, but each of which must be separated from the raw crude. In both of these cases, a series of separations is necessary to obtain the desired end product. In the case of oil refining, crude is subjected to a long series of individual distillation steps, each of which produces a different product or intermediate. Okay, quickly, let's go to the various techniques we have. All right, so the first, look at paper chromatography. Chromatography does this with anything that has to do with coloring, colors. This method is often used in the food industry. It is used to identify chemicals or coloring agents in food or drinks. Yes, it can identify coloring agents in food or drink. Also in plants, chlorophyll content. Yes, we use chromatography for that. So paper chromatography is used for this purpose. For example, if a scientist wants to know how many substances are in a particular blob of ink, paper chromatography can be used. So see the diagram right below. Okay, we said paper chromatography is a technique that involves placing a small dot or line of sample, like the diagram I showed in the previous slide, or a line of sample solution onto a strip of chromatography paper. The paper is placed in a container with a shallow layer of solvent and sealed. As the solvent rises through the paper, it meets the sample mixture, which starts to travel up the paper with the solvent. This paper is made of cellulose, a polar substance, and the compounds within the mixture travel further if they are non-polar. This paper is made of cellulose, a polar substance, and the compounds within the mixture, they travel farther if they are non-polar. More polar substances bond with the cellulose paper more quickly, and therefore they do not travel far. Let's see the diagram once again. Okay, I think this is the diagram. We'll have it right here. We'll have it right here. Okay. Sorry. Yes, we have the diagram right here. So that is how they travel up. When this process is kick-started. You see the different colors separating into the different colors in the mixture. They are separating into the various chambers, and then you can pick which of the colors are present in the mixture. Okay, next is filtration. Filtration. This is a common method of separating an insoluble solid from a liquid. Take note, not any kind of solid, an insoluble, because some solids are soluble. So it's a method of separating an insoluble solid from a liquid. An example of such a mixture is sand and water. Sand is insoluble and water. Filtration is used in water treatment plants where water from rivers is filtered to remove solid particles, water beds and all that. Water from rivers is filtered to remove solid particles. You have the diagram there. Filtration is any of various mechanical, physical or biological operations that separate solid from fluids by adding a medium through which only the liquid or the fluid can pass. The fluid that passes through is called the filtrate. The liquid you get after the filtration process that's taking place is called the filtrate. Then while the solid that remains, the insoluble solid that remains, is called the residue. And most of us that did senior WAEC or secondary school were doing practical, qualitative and quantitative analysis, practicals and SWOT analysis, will make use of these terms very well, residue and filtrate. And it is associated with filtration when they'll just tell you, add C, specimen C plus water. What do you observe? C is an insoluble salt, or C dissolves partially in water to give a colorless filtrate and a black or blue or green residue. When it's a green residue, you know, talking of copper, all right? So all those stuffs to give a residue and a filtrate, that's talking about filtration. And we use a filter paper. In a school laboratory, the filtration medium is a filter paper. Evaporation, the next one. Evaporation is a method for separating a mixture of a soluble solid and a solvent. Can you see the difference now? A mixture of a soluble solid and a solvent. Solvent means a liquid, liquid. The process involves heating the solution until the solvent evaporates, leaving behind the solid residue. Heating the solution. Solution is a mixture of solute and solvent. So heating the solution until the solvent evaporates, leaving the solid residue.